Good evening, everyone. It's really a pleasure to be here. Our speaker tonight is outstanding. His name is Jeff Hoffman. I got to be with him over the noon hour, and he is just a remarkable entrepreneur that's been successful as a proven CEO. He's done everything from run independent businesses to be a Hollywood film producer. Last year, even produced a Grammy-winning jazz album. So, a really multi-talented, fascinating man. Now, some of you may have heard about his little startup that grew, something called Priceline. I think you've heard of that. But very successful. I'm sure he'll have some good stories on that. But he's a frequent keynote speaker on the topics of innovation, entrepreneurship, and business leadership. He co-authored a book that I highly recommend called Scale. And it talks about working on your business, but not being completely engrossed in that business, but watching it grow and watching it be successful. He teaches lots of innovation workshops to major corporations, and just is a really outstanding person. Would you help me welcome Jeff?
Some lessons on what makes entrepreneurs successful. But I really want to start tonight by telling you guys a little bit about the journey. Not too long ago, I got a call, it was a high school. And a high school said, we'd like you to come talk at Career Day. And I remember looking at my phone saying, okay, obviously you got the wrong number because I don't have your definition of a career, right? When I was growing up, Career Day was doctors and lawyers and nurses, things like that. Actually, one time we had an astronaut, which was really cool. But entrepreneur was not a thing. Okay, and it wasn't a career. And the way that entrepreneurship was thought of was, in fact, entrepreneurs were just hustlers, and that was a negative connotation. They were people that couldn't apparently keep a regular job like everybody else. If you couldn't hold a job down, then you were out hustling, and that's what an entrepreneur was. And it was a negative thing at that time. This is what I heard my whole life, mostly from my parents, by the way. My whole life as an entrepreneur, people kept on saying, why can't you just get a job like everybody else? What is wrong with you? Why are you so unstable? I'm going to tell you a story that about my first company, but you know, interestingly, my stepfather, at one point, he asked me a question in the fall when I was an entrepreneur, what are you working on? And I told him. Then in December, we sold the company. In the spring, he asked me again, what are you working on? And it was something different. We started another company, and he said, you're really unstable. This is going to look really bad on your resume. And I remember thinking, okay, the fact that people keep buying the companies we start, if that's what looks bad on a resume, I'm pretty sure I'll never have one. It was just not an understanding of what entrepreneurship was. In fact, if I had had a business card back then, it would have never said the word entrepreneur. I can't even still spell that word today. It would have said problem solver. Because all I ever wanted to do was go solve problems in the world. And then when it's solved, solve another one, right? And it was interesting because if I launched a company, solved a problem, and sold it in 3 years, and next time we did it in 2 years, that's actually good. But you know what everyone else told me? You look really unstable on your resume, you're job hopping. Okay, so entrepreneurship, I just want you guys to know how lucky you are to be here, right? And that the university has the support of companies like Hills Bank, and that you have the John Papa John Entrepreneurship Center. You have all the programs, you have all the classes. You tell me 40 classes? 40 different classes here, thousands of students involved. You're getting an opportunity to do the things we're about to talk about that just didn't exist before you. So just to tell you my background very quickly, when I went to college, I got an engineering degree. Not because I wanted to be an engineer, but because my parents were pressuring me, you need to pick a major where you can get a job. And that seemed to be the only thing that mattered. And it was go get a good job at a good company and a good paycheck. And so I picked engineering because I knew I could get a job, not because I was passionate about it. It wasn't bad, not that it's a bad thing. I just want you to think about why you're choosing what you're choosing. It didn't last for me. And keep in mind, everything I'm going to tell you tonight, there is no right or wrong. Okay, this is a DNA thing. Every one of us has to follow our own path. So I'm going to tell you the life and career of an entrepreneur. That doesn't mean you have to choose it. It's just the path that I chose. I want to be clear about that. No right or wrong, just a DNA thing. But speaking of DNA, when I took the engineering job in the big corporation, and I will tell you the problem that I had, that I think someday if they do a DNA test, it's going to turn out that my DNA is like 80% sarcasm. And unfortunately, apparently corporate America fails to value sarcasm the way that I do. So it didn't go so well for me. I quit after just a few years, and I've been doing startups my entire life. I'm going to tell you about a few of them. But that's kind of the numbers. A couple of them were sold to big companies. We took a couple of them public. Two didn't work. Two are still going. So I've been doing that a long time. Let me tell you where it started for me, though. I grew up in a little desert town. I grew up in Arizona, in a small desert town where, just being honest, academics was far less important than Friday Night Lights. The week's football game was a much bigger deal than anything anybody was studying. And so there wasn't a push to achieve academically or really to pursue much. And I'm not saying this as a negative, I'm just saying it again as a reality. A lot of the people I grew up with literally never left a 5-square-mile area that they spent their whole lives. And that's fine, because that's what they wanted, but I didn't. I had big dreams and big goals, and I wanted to go do something and see the world and things that I wanted to pursue. So I charted a different path than all my friends, and I decided there was a program at this university at Yale that I really wanted to be in. And I understood, it was obviously not going to be easy to get in, and I knew it was expensive, but I worked really hard and I got into this school. And I went to the school, and I have to tell you, the beginning of it was not a good experience. I sent every cent that I had, worked every hour that I could in the summer, and when classes started on the first day, I was pretty much sent home. Because in fact, in all fairness to university, I didn't pay, right? I paid what I could, but I didn't pay enough. I couldn't afford the school. So they said, look, you can't go here if you don't pay the minimum amount. And with all the aid I got, so I got booted out of class. And I called my parents and said, hey, they're kicking me out because I didn't pay. And my parents said, well, just come home. And then I started calling my friends. I said, look, as hard as I worked to get into school, they're kicking me out, legitimately for financial reasons. And all my friends said, just go home. And I have to tell you, went outside, didn't go to class anyway, sitting on the steps. And I remember thinking this, I'm 18 years old. This is the first big problem I've ever faced in my life, and everybody's answer is quit. Well, what kind of precedent are you setting for your life if you quit as soon as it gets hard? So I'll tell you what I decided. I said, you know what, I'm not leaving here until I get that diploma. I will not leave here until it's across the stage, and that's the way that I exit. And I realized then nobody was supporting me, no one believed it was achievable, and no one wanted to help. They were annoyed that I was being so stubborn. Okay? So my first startup was started the second day of freshman year because I couldn't go to class that day either. So I started a software company, which would be fine except I don't know how to write software because they won't let me go to class and I haven't learned anything yet. But I started one anyway because I knew that was a good business to be in. I actually went around town, wrote proposals, and a company called me one day and said, your company's software proposal won, go build the software. So it was on that day. I went around the local schools and hung signs up programmers wanted. And that actually worked, because it turns out that, especially high school students, but college students, there were a lot of students that would work for pretty much pizza money. And it turns out business pays a lot more than that, so my margins were really good. I got students to write software, I sold it to companies, and I funded my entire education that way. Now, this was never a story about money. This is important. This was a story about goals. And I'm going to tell you now, entrepreneurs, people in general, that are focused on money, those aren't the ones that succeed. Those people, when the money's hard to find and you're not making it, those people quit. The key to successful entrepreneurship is being very goal and purpose driven. Right? So what I woke up every day thinking was not the money, even though it was money I needed. What I woke up every day thinking about was walking across that stage and getting that diploma that nobody thought was achievable. That kept me up every day. So when I left college, the lesson I learned, I still didn't want to be an entrepreneur, but I learned an important lesson. If you have really big dreams, which that was for me, and you're willing to work as hard as your dreams are big, you can do it. There is a way to accomplish things. And it turns out that the skills of entrepreneurship are the path to that accomplishment, right? The things I learned as an entrepreneur enabled me to actually determine my own future here. So I did go get that job. Told you I left, I've been doing startups since. As Brad mentioned, this is our most successful startup. This is a company today Like I was saying earlier today, it feels almost silly to say, because everyone has big dreams, but none of us ever dream this big. Company today, this was a startup, like everybody else. There are people in here that have startups, people that I know that have been working with on startups. This was a scratch startup like everybody else's. It's a company today that does business in 200 countries around the world. And somebody texted me something at lunch. Today, the companies have been on a real good roll lately. The company today, from scratch startup, is worth $71 billion. And we started this thing on a card table. So anything is possible. So let's talk about, I want to share with you some of the keys to success as an entrepreneur and what entrepreneurship really means. But I want to tell you where I've been gathering that. I made a commitment to giving back. And I have said all along that, by the way, entrepreneurship is, to me, entrepreneurship is not a job, it's a privilege. My friends say, man, I got to go to work. And you know what I say? I say, man, I get to go to work because I love what I do every single day. It is a privilege to be an entrepreneur and to get to learn these skills and do these things. So I made the commitment to giving back to entrepreneurship, which since you're all involved in it, I'll ask you to take the same challenge for yourself. Someday, somewhere, reach behind you, take the hand of someone else and pull them forward too. That's kind of our pay it forward thank you for the chance to be entrepreneurs in the world. But I made that commitment. So in 2011, I had one more internet company. I was the CEO of a company called ubid.com. We were the fifth largest auction site on the internet then. We took that company public as well. But I got to sort of the end of after eight startups and being a CEO most of my life, it just wasn't really lighting my fire anymore. So I at the end of 2011, I said, I'm gonna take off now and spend some time giving back. Just so you guys know, I was doing a grand social experiment in 2012. 2012, I said, I'm gonna take the whole year off and I am going to do this experiment, where for 1 year, I'm not gonna say no to anybody that asks me for help. So I won't do any work, I won't make any money, I won't go to my office. Anytime the phone rings, I'll just say yes to everybody that calls me and see how it goes. It was an amazing year. But it started, one of the first places I wound up was a 19-year-old West African kid in Senegal who saw my TED talk and sent me an email. Said, Mr. Hoffman, things are pretty tough here in the village. Any way you could help us. So I actually flew to West Africa, found myself in a village in Senegal, and I've been doing it ever since. I meant to take a year off, it's been 4 years, but I've just been traveling and meeting you guys. I'm on the way from here to meet with students and universities in Serbia, Croatia, Macedonia, and Albania next week. So I spend my time trying to learn from you guys and trying to mentor where I can. So a lot of what I'm sharing with you are not just my lessons, they're lessons collected from all over the world doing that. One other thing I want to mention, since this is a college campus, we have this crazy idea. And the part that's not crazy is my belief in you guys and this millennial generation, which is ironic because I always tell people to stop using that term. Because one thing millennials really hate is being called millennials. So I don't even like the term. However, you are the first generation ever raised entirely on technology and social media. So everything about you and the way you operate is different. And the silver lining of the bad things that my generation did, everything, if you think about everything from Occupy Wall Street to Enron to Bernie Madoff to the car, you know, AIG, the car industry bailouts, there's so many things that our generation did driven by money and profits and things that aren't necessarily bad, but an overemphasis on that, that the time that I spend with your generation, you guys are the ones that have said, you know what, you guys messed it up bad enough, let us fix it. So you're the generation that said, we're gonna go make it all better. We're gonna solve the problems. You are the generation of entrepreneurs. I actually fundamentally believe that if you wanna make the world a better place, you just unleash armies of entrepreneurs and they'll go fix everything, and that's you guys. And I know you'll do it. So we had this grand experiment 2 summers ago. We said, let's prove it. So this was our crazy idea. What if we charted a ship, put you guys on it and sailed around the world so you could see all the world's problems? By the way, you got it nicer. Right? Here in Iowa, this is a really nice place to live. I was thinking that as I was flying in today, looking at all the green in the farms. We live nice here. The rest of the world doesn't. So what we did was we chartered the ship. We took students from all over. We put them on the ship. We literally sailed around the entire planet. It took the entire summer. And we exposed students like you guys to problems all over the world, from villages of Africa to rural India to Cambodia, wherever. And the fifth deck of that ship was an accelerator, an incubator, and we launched companies as we sailed around the world. And you know, I gotta tell you, you guys made me proud, right? You guys figuratively, because unbelievable solutions were created. So that's what I've been doing the last few years, and I'm going to share lessons with you guys. By the way, I'll have my email address at the end. We're doing this again next summer. If any students or even faculty as mentors want to go on the next cruise around the world, just send me an email and put you on the list for doing that. So what is entrepreneurship about? And here's something really, really bad. I don't like the definition that media does, right? If you think about it, what movie was made about entrepreneurship? The Facebook movie, Social Network. What is all the focus? I want to be a billionaire. I think that song was even written for that. It's too much focus on two things, making money and on online businesses. So when you say entrepreneurship, people think, I don't want to launch an internet company, so I don't want to be an entrepreneur. That is the wrong definition. So one of my most important messages to you guys tonight is that's not what entrepreneurship is about. It isn't about, it really isn't even about business. Business is the tool, but it's not about money. What entrepreneurship is about is self-determination. Entrepreneurs are the people that get to design the future, right? Instead of waiting, everyone else is waiting and hoping the future brings them something good. Entrepreneurs say, I ain't waiting, I'm just gonna design it. That's the beauty of entrepreneurship. So if you want to design the life you've always dreamed of, entrepreneurship is the tool set that you use to do that. So where does all that start? It starts with your attitude, okay? This is a really important point. So I'm gonna tell you a story about attitude. And I've been studying everywhere that I can, trying to study successful people. I'll give you a few examples tonight. And try to figure out what is it that they do that everybody else doesn't. Why are some people successful in whatever their field is, sports, entertainment, business, medicine, whatever? What are the common traits of the world's most successful people? So whenever I get to hang with people that did something successful, I study that a lot. Like I just came back from a trip that I did to the UK with Steve Wozniak. Woz and Steve Jobs created Apple. So while Woz and I were traveling, it's the same thing. I'm trying to figure out what is it about this guy that made him and Jobs billionaires for their company, for what they launched. I just did President Obama's Global Entrepreneurship Summit out in Silicon Valley that I spoke at. But some of the other entrepreneurs that spoke, founders, Travis created Uber, Brian created Airbnb, and then Zuckerberg was with us as well. So when you talk to those three people, we were all speakers at this thing, trying to figure out what the common elements are. That's what I'm about to share with you. The entrepreneurs that were successful, what are they doing? I'm gonna tell you, the first part, it starts with your attitude, right? And I want you to think about this bigger than entrepreneurship in life. So I was 10 years old, and I went to my buddy's house next door, and all my friends were in Mike's room, and they were all, he bought a poster at the mall, and everyone was all excited about this poster, and I couldn't understand what the excitement was. The poster was a picture of a Ferrari. Okay, I didn't even know what that was. But actually, I will tell you, the real poster had a hot chick in a bikini sitting on the hood of the car. But we were 10. And I remember one of my friends saying this. He said, that is so gross, that girl's bare butt is touching that fine car. Okay, so we were all about this car, but I didn't know why. So I went home and I said, Mom, can I ask you a question? My mom said, what? And I said, what's the deal? What's the fascination? Why is everybody so fascinated by this poster? My mom said, what was it? And I said, it was a Ferrari. And she said, oh, that explains it. And I said, how does that explain it? My mom said, because it's unattainable. It's a fantasy, a dream, something that you'll never have. And I said, oh, my bad, because I thought Ferraris were real cars. My mom said, no, that's a real car. She said, just neither you nor anybody you know will ever drive that car. And I said, wait, why? And my mom said, son, don't worry about it. You're never gonna drive a car like that. Nor is anybody you know. So I went to school the next day, and as an experiment, I said to all my buddies, when I grow up, I'm gonna buy a Ferrari, and everybody laughed. I said, why is that funny? And guys, this isn't a story about cars or money. I'm not even a car guy. It's a story about setting limits and letting the world set limits on you. So I said, why is everybody laughing? They're like, dude, you're not gonna ever have a Ferrari. I said, why not? They said, Jeff, that's a $1 million car. And they said, you're never gonna buy that. None of us are ever gonna buy that. And I was thinking, yeah, with that attitude, we won't. Right? Everybody's already saying no. So I started thinking about the fact that why do you let anybody but you set your ceiling? Why should anybody be able to tell you? And by the way, to be fair, everybody I told I was going to drive a Ferrari one day laughed and said it ain't going to happen. So you have a choice, which is to let the whole world tell you what you can and can't do, or you make that decision. I'll tell you what I did. I went to the mall, rode my bike to the mall, bought that poster. I brought the poster home, and I wrote a list of things on the back of it when I was a kid. And I said, if I can ever achieve this list of things, I'm buying that car. And I don't even want the car, guys. I just want to prove it can be done because everybody told me you will never have a car like that. So I was trying to prove that the world shouldn't decide what you're capable of. Only you can decide that, even when everyone around you is telling you not good enough, which is all I ever heard. Just a kind of a quick funny story. When I was in high school, I was getting ready for football practice. I was looking for something in my closet, and that poster fell out. And I was 17 then. And I was looking at the poster. My mom came in. My mom goes, "Son, you got to go. You'll be late for practice." I said, "I'm coming." And she looks over my shoulder, and she says, "Oh, I see you found that car again." And I'm looking, and I'm looking, and I'm looking. And I said, "Wait, what car?" My mom said, "Oh, I see we finally found the girl on the poster." And I said, "Okay." And my mom said, "Son?" And I said, "Yeah, Mom." And she pointed to the hot chick, and she said, "You ain't getting one of those either." And I said, "Geez, thanks, Mom. Thanks for the book there." And I said, "Mom, one more question." And she said, "What?" And I said, "Suppose I drove that car." My mom said, "Fine, that chick would probably show up." And I said, "Okay, just now I know how the world works." It was a lesson in the fact that you set your goals and you don't let anybody else ever tell you what you can or you can't do. Okay, what did I hit that made that thing happen? Paul? I don't know. There's a secret guy out there. So we said it starts with having a big dream, right? And not letting anybody ever talk you out of it. But I want to share something with you. When you talk about dreams, the younger you are, the more dreams you have. And when I ask kids, "What do you want to be when you grow up?" they all have big, crazy dreams and answers. And as people get older, when I say, "What are your dreams?" they start to go away. And they hit a point when I get to adults, when I say, "What are your dreams? What were you going to be when you grow up?" And you know what they do? They roll their eyes and they say, "Jeff, at some point you got to grow up." And I said, "Wait, what does that mean?" And they said, "I got bills to pay. I got a family. I got to get a job and make ends meet." And they said, "You just got to grow up. And therefore, you have to sweep all your dreams under the carpet." And I remember thinking, is that growing up or is that giving up? Because that's what I think it is, not growing up. There is a fundamental belief, we were just having this conversation right here beforehand, that you have to choose. I can chase my dreams or passions, or I can be a responsible adult and go get a good job that makes money. I'm here to tell you, you do not have to make that choice, okay? Chasing your dreams and the things you believe in does not make you irresponsible at all, okay? Not paying your bills actually does make you irresponsible, but let me tell you how to do both, because I don't want anyone ever to convince you that it's a choice. All right, so the first thing you have to do is you've got to write your dreams down. And here's why. When I started asking people about their dreams and where they went, they don't want to talk about it. They don't want to think about it because they know they abandoned those dreams to be a grown-up. All right? So here's what I do, what I recommend to you. I write them down. I write my dreams on little index cards. And you know where I put them? On my bathroom mirror. You know why? Because every night, when I come home, I look at that mirror, I look at that dream, and I say, "What did I do today to get any closer to making that reality?" And every morning when I wake up, I look at my mirror, and I say, "What am I going to do today to get any closer to the thing I wanted?" So let me tell you one of mine. This was one of mine I wrote down as a kid. When I would have a bad day as a child, and for some reason I kept winding up stuck in my room, and not by my choice, when I would have a bad day, here's what I would do to get away mentally. I didn't want to just sit in my room for hours. So I had a globe in my room, and I would spin this globe. And what I would do is close my eyes and just point to pick a country. Turns out the Earth is 75% water, so you got to spin it four times. But eventually, I would pick a country. And what I would do is I would go research that country. And then when I go to bed that night, the way I would escape my troubles is I spent the afternoon reading about that country, like Morocco, and camels, and trekking, and Marrakesh, and all that stuff. I go to sleep, and I dream of far-off places. So I decided as a kid, before I die, I'm going to visit 50 countries. So I wrote that in an index card and stuck it on my mirror. Some of you have vision boards or whatever, but I don't care what age you are in this room. You still have the rest of your life left, and there are things you still want to do. You should write them down and put them somewhere where you cannot hide from them anymore, where you see them every day. So here's what happened. I already told you I went and got an engineering job, and mostly because my parents were saying, "You got loans to pay now, you got bills, go be a responsible adult." So I got the engineering job, which I'm not saying is a wrong thing at all. But I got the good job at the good company and the good paycheck, which was fine, except that I had everything but a good life. I literally hated work every single day. I stared at the clock the whole day and just waited for it to end and thought, this is it. This is what I did all this work for. I wasn't happy. Again, just a personal thing. One day, it's lunchtime and I get in the elevator. And I see this guy, Brian, a friend of mine. I was like, Brian, what are you doing here? And he's like, I work here. He said, Jeff, what are you doing here? I said, I work here. He's like, how do we work at the same company? And I didn't even know you worked here. I never saw you. I said, Brian, where do you work? He said, I work on the sixth floor. I'm in marketing. And I said, oh, that explains it. I'm an engineer. I work on the fourth floor. There's no, I don't go to marketing, but I don't go to the sixth floor. I come up every day, go to my cubicle on four, and go home. I'm an engineer. He's up in marketing. So I went home that night. I was brushing my teeth, and that's what was on my mirror. Only this time it was mocking me. And I looked at that card, and I thought about what I was doing with my life. And I thought to myself the following. Visit 50 countries in my life, I don't even visit the sixth floor, okay? One time, I got off on five, but I realized my mistake and ran right back onto the elevator. I can't even look at the fifth floor and say, how am I ever gonna visit 50 countries in my life if I don't even visit the sixth floor? So I'll tell you what I did, I quit. I quit that job, and I said, entrepreneurs have the privilege of taking their dreams here, their responsibilities here, and designing their future, designing a company. So by the way, are you surprised now to find out that Priceline's a travel company? It does business all over the world? Maybe it's no accident that I got into that business. I'll tell you what happened. I started my first company, and I'll tell you about it in just a minute, but it was in the travel, it was way before Priceline. It was in the travel business. And one day later, my friends called, and they said, hey man, you coming over to watch the game Saturday? I said, I won't be here. They said, where are you gonna be? I said, I'll be in the Netherlands. And they're like, the Netherlands? How are you pulling that off? And I said, check this out. This is the coolest thing ever. It's my job, okay? I created a company selling products to airlines and airports. So guess what happened every week? I had to fly to a different country to sell products. I was paying my bills and living my dream at the same time because I designed a company around the thing that I wanted to do. The very first customer was KLM, Royal Dutch Airlines, called me one day, said, hey, any way we could fly you over at our expense to Holland and give you a little tour while you're here, we'd like to give you a big check and buy your product. I said, geez, I'll get back to you. That was a pretty easy call. I designed a business around the things that I've always dreamed of doing. Let me tell you another one. I had written down, all of us have our, whatever, your dreams. And it doesn't matter what they are, I'm just sharing what mine were. But whatever yours are, the goal is to design a career around those dreams that let you do those things. By the way, I'm gonna tell you something now, one of the punchlines. The way that you do that is by becoming a problem solver. Whatever industry you really wanna be in, go study the industry and find out what problems are the hard ones to solve and then go learn how to solve them. When you become a valuable problem solver in any industry, suddenly you're in. So this was one of mine. I said, before I die, some people want to climb Mount Everest, like I said, I wanted to make a movie. And then I wanted to produce a concert, and maybe a music tour. These are just dreams of mine. Someday I want to produce a concert, and I want to go up on a stage like this and introduce a concert that I just put on. That was a dream, right? But when I told everybody I was going to do that, it's the same laughter. Dude, you're an engineer. You're an internet guy. You're a tech guy. You don't know anything about music. So let me tell you what I did. My dream was to be on stage introducing a concert one day. So I studied the music biz, and I said, what are all the things they do in that industry? And I crossed off all the ones I can't do. Can't sing, can't dance, can't produce, can't write music. What's left? Well, it turns out, like every other business, there are finance people, there are accounting people, there are marketing people, there are product people, there are sales people, right? There are project management people. When I wrote it up down, it turns out there's a bunch of things I can do in this industry. So I picked some that I became really proficient at, really good at. That's what I'm telling you, whatever industry you want to be in. Everybody said, you're an engineer, you'll never get in the music biz, and we did it anyway, because I found problems that I could solve that everybody needed. I remember, I'm just going to go back to the attitude thing for a minute here. I remember also one time in high school, my sister and her friends were on a Saturday all excited in the living room looking at pictures. I said, what are you guys looking at? And my sister showed me pictures. They were all excited because they went to the Elton John concert tonight. And they were thrilled. And I was like, Jesus, not like you met the guy and just went to the concert. Like, Jeff, we saw Elton John live. It was amazing. We were in the building, right? And I was like, okay, but you're awfully excited about it. And they said, you don't understand. We were in the building. We saw him live. So as I was walking away, the sarcasm thing again, I said, you know what? Someday when Elton and I are friends, I'll tell him you like his music. And they all burst out laughing. And I whipped around. And I said this. I said, why is that funny? And my sister said, Jeff, in a million alternate universes, you're never going to be friends with Elton John. Okay? So I started walking away, and there's that, the world's already telling you what you can't do. Limits thing. So I started thinking. I said, okay, how could it happen? Is there any possible path in my life that I would ever be friends with Elton John? Now, I'm a kid in a desert town in the middle of nowhere, and this is an international knighted Sir Elton John superstar. The odds are low, but the odds are not zero. So let me tell you another technique that I kind of created that day. When you have a big dream and a big goal, and you're standing where you are today and looking at it, you're in school and you're looking at some big dream you have, it looks like an impossibly high mountain. If you start with where you are, little desert town, unknown kid, world superstar. So Elton and I are going to be friends. Where is that path? That is a giant, steep, icy mountain that I can't climb. So I tried something, which is what I do now, that I'll recommend to you. Plan your goals backwards. Project yourself at the top of the mountain you want to be on, and then plan backwards. Let me tell you how that worked. I sat there and I said, okay, let's do an experiment. I'm going to plan my goals backwards. Right now I'm friends with Elton John. What had to happen the day before that? I had to meet Elton John. What had to happen the day before that? Someone had to introduce me. But the day before that, I had to know somebody that knew him. The day before that, I had to know anybody in the music business. The day before that, I had to have any skill that anybody in the music business would ever take a meeting with me. The day before that, I had to go learn that skill. You see where I'm going? By the time you're done, all of a sudden the path is right there. And I looked up and I said, it may be a 1 in a million chance, but there's one chance that this thing could happen. Because I planned it by projecting myself there and working backwards. So now I'm going to tell you kind of a cool day in my life. I was backstage about to introduce my friend Elton John. We were doing a charity concert together. It was just a funny story because the phone rang, it was my sister. And she said, what are you doing? I said, I got to call you back, I'm busy. And she said, where are you? I said, I'm in a concert, I'll call you later. She said, with who? I said, I'm in a concert, I'm about to introduce Elton, he and I are doing a charity event together. She said, who are you really with? Now I had long forgotten this whole thing. But it was funny, because I gave him the phone. And my sister, he said, hello. He said, hi, this is Elton. And she said, excuse my French, I'm going to tell the real story. She said, give my brother the phone. I'll change it a little. She said, give my brother the phone back, you jerk. And he said, whoa, your sister doesn't like me. And he said, she said, and tell your friend that's not even a real British accent. It was kind of a funny moment, because right then I realized, oh my God, there was a day when I was a kid that I told my sister one day this would happen. It's because, one, I believed it would happen, two, I found problems to solve in the industry, and three, I drew a path backwards from the goal that moment occurred, and I took that picture to send her for the fact that it had actually happened. This is, I won't get into the details here, but I wanted to do concert tour, so I was on tour with NSYNC then. That's Justin Timberlake standing right to the left of me there. And we were on tour, and I just want to tell you something about your attitude and about believing. I studied the tour industry. I made a list of all the things I couldn't do. Then I made a list of all the hard problems, like distribution, promotion, tour support, and financing. And I said, I'm going to pick one of those, and I'm going to become valuable in this industry. And there I was one day. I'll just cut to the chase. Heinz Stadium, Pittsburgh, when it first opened, the first event there was not the Pittsburgh Steelers game. It was the NSYNC concert. At the moment, they were the biggest band in the world. The place was rocking, 70,000 people, sold out several nights on this tour. And I remember I was backstage, and the guys actually went in the tunnel. They wanted to see where the Steelers come out. So we were standing under all those screaming people. And I remember turning to these guys, to Justin Timberlake, and saying, did you ever in your wildest dreams imagine you'd be standing here right now? That they're the biggest band in the world and 70,000 screaming fans a night. And Justin said something that really made me think. He said, hey, Jeff, and I said, what? And he said, did you ever in your wildest dreams imagine you'd be the guy standing here with us? And the answer, guys, is yeah, kind of, right? Because I never believed it was impossible. I was willing to work hard enough, and I was willing to draw a path, find a way I could be valuable in this particular industry. The last one Brad mentioned, oh, that was the film business. We did the same thing again. That's me being killed in a scary movie that we made. That's my friend Eli Roth. We started our first movie company together and created that first film. You don't need to go see it if you don't know it. We've done a bunch of them since. But it was just the same story that when I said I'm going to go to Hollywood and make a movie, everybody said, you're nuts, you know nothing about it. So I studied it. I found some problems. I learned how to solve them. I went up out of the industry. When we created this movie, all my friends were like, you're just wasting your time and money. And so later, people would ask me, how'd your little movie go with kind of, you know, teasing me. We made that little movie for $1.3 million. Now that's real money, but that's not Hollywood money. And 46 countries later, that movie grossed $100 million. It's one of the top grossing independent horror flicks ever. The project worked because we followed all these principles that we're talking about tonight. The last piece that I wanted to show you was, Brad mentioned last year I won a Grammy. So that's me on the red Grammy carpet. I was getting yelled at because I was taking pictures of all the paparazzi taking my picture. But it was a moment that in a million years, yeah, they were screaming, put the camera down, put the phone down. I was standing there, one of the reporters yelled to me, the same thing, did you ever dream, right, that this moment could possibly happen? You ever be standing on the, not only standing on the Grammy red carpet, but we actually won our category for jazz. And actually it was funny, because you know what my first response was? I said to all the media, I said, this is the dream of software engineers everywhere. And it was like, they're just jumping silence. They're like, what? Because I was sitting there thinking, what am I doing here? But the answer is yeah. Every door, never close the door to any dream completely. As long as there's a crack of light, and that crack of light is leaving that dream written down where you see it, never stop thinking about it, and making a plan to get there, anything is possible. So that's what entrepreneurs do. They plan their path to those dreams. Today, I do a lot of work still because I developed a set of skills or problems I know how to solve in the music biz, as an example. So in the last few weeks, I'm working on a startup, I don't know what kind of music you guys listen to, but it's fun for me because it's people that I've always been fans of and now I'm partners with, doing a project with Pitbull, that's actually a tech startup that we've got involved in. Doing a project now with Christina Aguilera that called me and said something that she wanted to work on. I got a call on the way here from Nelly that has a project that he wants to work on. So it has enabled me, because I developed a skill, that these people that I never dreamed of meeting, now actually, they'll call you when you do that. So let me go into the last part of the presentation. I want to share with you some of the keys to success. If you want to be an entrepreneur, what do you got to get right? What do you got to know, and what do the successful ones do? And I'm going to start with this. The first thing you have to do is solve a real problem. Today, people pitch me stuff all the time. I'm everywhere that I go. I was here a couple of months ago at the fairgrounds with Kevin Harrington from Shark Tank, and we did the Young Entrepreneurs Convention event. And I listened to a lot of pitches from a lot of Iowa entrepreneurs, including students from here. And so many people have a solution that's looking for a problem. They've come up with some idea that no one really exists. Here's what I'm going to tell you what entrepreneurs do that everybody else doesn't, that I really want to share with you, make sure we're still okay on time, which is solve real problems. Now, when you go out in the world, everywhere you go, every week, every day, whatever, you encounter problems. Here's what most people do. They go home and complain. How was your day? It was horrible. I went at lunch to do this thing, and the idiots made me wait in line for 3 hours. You know, it shouldn't have taken 3 hours. You complain. You might tweet that. You might change your status to irritated, right? Because those idiots made me wait in line for 3 hours. Everybody in the world complains about problems every day. If you want to be a successful entrepreneur, do these three things instead. The first thing you do is stop at the problem and ask this question. Does this bother anybody else but me? Right, in class, you're going to call that market sizing, okay? Is this a big problem that a lot of people have? If the answer to that is yes, entrepreneurs do a second thing that no one else does. Entrepreneurs do the research. Is there a solution out there and we just don't have it here in Iowa or wherever? And if the answer to that is no, then entrepreneurs do a third thing that no one else does. They say, you guys go home without me, I'm not leaving until this is fixed. Next time you see a real problem that makes you complain, stop and do that. Say, I had a friend of mine once could not find a song that he was looking for. He was really irritated, so he sat down and wrote Pandora. I don't know if any of you have ever used it. He wrote Pandora because he was so irritated that he couldn't find a song. So many great startups, great products, great technologies were created because someone wouldn't walk away from the problem. So let me tell you my quick point. So I told you I quit my corporate job. I'm an engineer, I have a great paycheck, a great job, I can't take it anymore, I quit. I just can't do this because I'm never going, like I told you guys, never going to see 50 countries in my life sitting in my cubicle where I don't even go up to the sixth floor. So I quit, and I said, I've got to find a way to create value in the travel industry because that's where I want to be. Later we created it in the music biz, later we created it in the film biz. Whatever you want to do, whether it's medicine, accounting, engineering, whatever, construction, farming, it doesn't matter. If you create value in an industry, the sky's the limit. You can do anything you want to do. So I quit the job, and I was trying to launch something. And I didn't really have much money, so an airline ticket was an expensive thing for me. So I bought an airline ticket and went to the airport. At the time, I'm waiting in line to get my to check in. The line takes 59 minutes. When I get to the front of the line, the lady says, next, I give her my driver's license. She looks at it, hits one button, print, it prints the boarding pass and hands it to me. And I was like, are you kidding me? You made me stand here for an hour so you could hit print? And she said, sir, you gotta have a boarding pass to get on a plane. I said, I understand that, but it's a printer. You hit one button, I stood an hour for you to hit print. And she's like, sir, you have to have a boarding pass to get through security, next. And I was really irritated. So instead of leaving and telling everyone I missed my flight, which I did, because they're so inefficient, I turned around to all the people in the line. And I said, now remember, at this point, I'm irritated because I'm 20-something years old, unemployed, and broke. There's no food in my fridge at all. So I'm under a lot of pressure. I turn around and I say, hey, to all those people, I said, am I the only one irritated that it takes an hour to get and all they do is print a boarding pass? Everybody groaned. So I said, okay, market sizing complete. Everybody agrees this is a big problem. And then I said the next thing, which is value equation. It's great that people complain, but are you fixing a problem anybody would pay you to fix? Is there a business here? So I said this. I said, would anybody, and I yelled this out, would anybody in this line give me $5 if I could give you a boarding pass right now and you can skip the line? You know what happened? People in the back of the line were yelling, 10, 15, 20. I was like, okay, now I really have a business. Right? And I was saying, I don't have your boarding pass right now. But people were saying, I'll give you $20 to skip the line. Just give me a boarding pass. Business people, whose time is worth more than that line of money. So then I did the third thing. I literally said, this didn't work at the time, but I said to everybody, stay here, I'll be back. Okay, no one stayed. But that Friday, I started my first company at 20-something years old. We designed, invented, patented, and sold all over the world those kiosks. When you check in at an airport now and get your own boarding pass, we invented that. That was my first startup, was these ticket kiosks now. And guess what happened? The picture I showed you from Holland? Now I had a product that I could sell to airports, so every week I was in a different country installing these in airports and getting paid. Then I'll tell you what happened. As I told you, I'm not a money guy, but I want to illustrate the relationship of solving real problems to value in the business world. One day, after running this company, we were doing really well. Everybody was buying the product. And one day, I look up from my office, and there's all these dark-suited business people that are called mergers and acquisitions. I didn't even know what those terms. They said M&A, and I didn't know what that meant. Okay, I was trying to figure out. I know that A&M is agriculture, but I couldn't figure out what they were in. And I said, we're going to help you guys with. And they said, company's amazing, product's amazing, we want to buy your company. I'm not a money-driven person, but I just want to illustrate this to you. So I sold that company after 3 years for $100 million. It's not internet money, but I was 20-something years old and broke the day before. That's not a bad check to get when you're a broke, unemployed, everyone's yelling at you person. So guess what happened? I was pursuing my dreams, but guess what else I was doing? Being a responsible adult. My parents called, said, you need help, you need any money? I said, you know what, Mom, I'm actually good right now. I'm actually paying my bills and I'm a responsible adult. It turned out that we were able to give a lot of that money away and be even a responsible citizen. We funded a shelter, a home for abused women in our community. We built houses. We did all kinds of things. So it turns out we were grown-ups, we were responsible, and I got there by pursuing my dream of travel and solving a problem in that industry. Now, I want to tell you something really important. Probably the most important thing I'm going to tell you the entire night, and that's this. Don't chase money, chase excellence. Okay? Money follows excellence. Why am I telling you that? Everybody that's been really successful that I know, their story never starts with, we were just trying to get rich. Their story starts with a big goal or a big dream and a passion for fixing that. It's very, very clear that people driven by passion and purpose far outperform people driven by paycheck. There's just no two ways about it. Focus on excellence. In Silicon Valley, this drives me nuts. I don't know why they keep inviting me out there to talk. In Silicon Valley, they focus very heavily on the exit strategy. Right at the start, what's your exit strategy? You know what I'm always thinking? I'm sitting there thinking, what's your entrance strategy? What are you exiting, your PowerPoint? You don't even have a business and you're talking about selling it while you still have a PowerPoint? It's ridiculous. All those people that are focused on a PowerPoint, a good investor pitch, and an exit strategy at the beginning aren't focusing on the only thing that counts, excellence. Go build something amazing in your life and you will never worry about money. We were heads down focused on building these kiosks so people could get their own boarding pass, that by the time we were done, I just looked up and somebody walked in with a truckload of money. Every company we ever built, by the way, at the start of Priceline, the focus was never on what's the exit strategy. I'm not saying it's not important. I'm saying it doesn't matter anyway until you create excellence. What we were focused on was operational excellence. So in Priceline, you notice, all these years later, was never sold. As I said earlier today at the Hills Bank luncheon, Priceline was the first stock in S&P market history to hit $1,000 a share. The stock went, like, in the last 4 years from like $400 to, I think it's $1,400-something today. The company wound up becoming worth $70 billion because every single quarter it's profitable. We focused on excellence and building. They said internet companies can't make money, right? And they can't be profitable. Facebook never was. Amazon's never turned a profit. But because of the focus on excellence, Priceline, again, I'm guessing my memory serves me right. I think last year's numbers were like sales of somewhere around $10, $11 billion and a net profit of $3.3 billion that the company makes every year. When you build excellence, you don't have to worry about money. Focus on excellence. Do something amazing in your life, and even like if you're like me and you don't care about money, you'll get paid anyway, if that's what you care about. Next, win a gold medal at one thing. I get so many entrepreneurs that come up to me, including last time I was here in Iowa, and they say, I got these six ideas. And I say, okay, good, get rid of five of them and pick one. And they say, but if I let those go, someone else will do them. Let them. You'll have five more ideas when you're done. But here's the important thing. You cannot be doing 1/6 of six things is not the path to excellence. The path to excellence is to win a gold medal at something in your life. And I'll tell you why I use that that analogy, although I think I'm going to have to stop using Hope Solo. Not actually on the team anymore. I just realized that. Anyway, to win a gold medal. To win a gold medal in soccer, you don't come home, shoot some hoop, play a little softball, kick the soccer ball around for 10 minutes, watch TV, and then go swim. You play soccer 6 hours a day since you were 4 years old. Winning a gold medal at anything requires extreme dedication and focus. You ain't going to win it at six things. Find something in your life that you can be the best at and stop trying to be anything else. You can be. Now, I told you I was a marketing guy, an engineer, later a film producer, but never, ever, ever did I do any of those things at the same time. At any given time in your life, do one thing and do it unbelievably well. That means go find the one thing that you can do unbelievably well. Find out. By the way, I'll give you a little experiment for how to do that. Text 10 of your friends. Send a text to 10 people and tell them, to ask them this. What is the one thing in the world you think I'm best at? And you will be amazed. Your 10 friends will pick something that say, you are the most amazing blank I've ever met. Whatever that is, that's probably your gold medal talent, and that's probably what you should be focused on. So when people talk, and I'll give you an example of what that looks like. When I do market research everywhere I am, when I'm in lines especially. So I'm standing in the grocery store, and there's some kids in front of me. And just out of curiosity, I say, you guys shop at Amazon? Kid says, everybody shops at Amazon. And I said, what do they sell? And the kid says, Amazon sells everything. And I said, really? I said, do you think I could buy a book on Amazon? And this is a quote, true story. The kid says, books are lame, Amazon doesn't sell those. I said, first of all, books are not lame. And second of all, Amazon sells books. Here's the interesting part. At the beginning of the internet, there weren't many of us building internet companies, so we all knew each other. I used to talk to Jeff and Pierre, they were building something called eBay. And I used to talk to this Jeff, he was building something called Amazon. Jeff always intended for Amazon to be a marketplace of everything. But what did he do? He said, I'm going to be the best darn bookseller on the planet. For years, he had the discipline to only do one thing. Amazon only sold books for many years until he became a gold medalist. And you and I said, it's only a book, but what an amazing company. Sell me something else. Another friend of mine, Tony, Tony Shea created this company, Zappos. When Tony started, here's what Tony said. I'm going to be the best darn shoe seller on the planet. Zappos sold nothing but shoes for years. Later, you can sell a lot of products. But if you want to become successful and achieve greatness, not just good, you've got to be the best at something. These companies did not start where they are. They started being the best darn shoe seller, the best darn bookseller. Our company, by the way, we just said we're going to be the hotel kings. We're going to be that company. People said Priceline should sell luggage to travelers, travel insurance, all these things. The company said we're going to be the gold medalist in hotels. Today, again, I told you the company sells hotels in 200 different countries and really nothing else. 90% of the revenue is from hotels because we won a gold medal at something. So don't try to do too many things. Pick one thing at a time in your life and crush it. That's your key to success. Once you crush it, no matter what it is, it's not bad if somebody comes up to you, whatever it is you build. You could be the virtual reality guy. I have people that don't know my name, they just say, aren't you the Priceline guy? It isn't a bad thing, because what do they think? We won a gold medal in something. Those guys must know how to build excellence, because they built that. Early in my career, people would look at those kiosks and say, wait, you built these? Just win a gold medal in one thing in your life. Harvest ideas, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this. I just want to tell you that you have to accept, when we talk about failure, and by the way, in Silicon Valley, as you guys know, I think they've taken it too far. They have failure parties, like it's a good thing, where you can't come unless you failed at something, and they celebrate it. I think that's absurd. I told somebody, you know, that's literally like the Brazilian soccer team going into the locker room before the World Cup final and saying, I really hope we lose today because it'll make us better people. Okay, said no one ever. All right? No one goes out there hoping to lose and fail. You go out there playing to win. The difference is when you lose, you shake it off and come back again and play another day. Failure is part of it. You don't shoot for it. You just accept it and get over it and move on. That's a big piece of what you do. Therefore, some large percent of all your brilliant, world-changing ideas are going to fail. Let them go. When it's clear that it's not going to work, move on to the next one. Somebody said to me once, you seem to have done a lot of stuff in your life. And you know why that is? It's because I don't waste time. When something's not working, you check your ego at the door and say, okay, I was wrong. And you're going to be abused. People are going to laugh at you and ridicule you. Oh, I thought this was the greatest idea ever. You've got to be tough enough to be an entrepreneur to say, I tried it, I was wrong. It's a numbers game. You will try a lot of ideas, and a lot of them will fail. But if you try, whatever, 99 things in a row that fail, and the 100th one is your price line, nobody remembers the other 99 things. It takes pushing the edge. If you never fail, it just means you're not trying hard enough. I did this event recently that I did with Tony Hawk, the skater, and we were sitting on two chairs with a group of you guys talking, and I said to Tony, for those of you not into skateboarding, Tony was the first skater in history to nail a double 360, a 720 in competition. It had never been done before and land on the board. So I turned to Tony and I said, so I take it the very first time you tried the 720, you just stuck it. And he said, are you nuts? I said, wait, you didn't just get it right the first time? He said, Jeff, my mom took me to the hospital 6 times for 6 different broken bones. He said, stitches like 11 times. He said, I fell and broke everything and bled everywhere, and eventually I got it. And I said, interesting. So you failed? He said, I failed like 12,000 times before I got it right the first time. It's funny how everybody else sports, right? If you're in baseball and you hit 250, that means you missed 3 out of 4 chances at bat, and that's acceptable. You need to learn to accept that failure is just part of it. So keep on harvesting ideas. I'm going to skip that part for now in the interest of time. And I'm going to tell you this, because I want to make sure we have time for some questions. It all starts right here, where you are in these seats and these classes on this campus. Here is why. Everybody, a lot of times students especially will say to me, well, why do I need to go to college? Why do I need to get an education? I'm learning things I'll never use. I just want to go start my company. And here is, and it is true, that there is the 1 in a million college dropout to start an internet company. What you're not seeing is, that's a sexy story, when a college dropout starts an internet company and succeeds. What you're not seeing is, out of 100 successful companies, the other 99 people succeeded because of their education. And one person, whose odds do you want? The 1 in a million college dropout are the 99 people who are well educated, and that's why they succeeded. And here's the answer. I will admit, when students say to me, why do I need to learn this stuff? I'm never going to use it again. I will tell you the truth. No one has ever pulled into the parking lot of my office, jumped out of the car, ran in and said, Mr. Hoffman, quick, I need the square root of a number. Okay? That has not happened, even though I learned how to compute the square root of a number. But it's because it misses the point, guys. You're not here at college. I gave the commencement speech at Kent State University last year. And at the beginning, I said, and it's a campus of about 25,000 people, so we had a big auditorium full. And I said, congratulations, your education is finally over. And they all cheered. And I said, just kidding, it starts today. What you're learning here is how to learn. What you're learning here is problem solving, structured thinking, analytical thinking, research. When I started at 20-something years old as a CEO who failed the only job he had, my 40-year-old employees would come to me and say, boss, we got a problem. And I was like, why are you asking me? I've never even had a job, right? And they're saying, well, you're the boss. And I said, I'm the guy that hired you because I don't know. And sometimes they would say, well, we don't know what to do. So you know what I would do? I would use the research techniques that my American history teacher taught. I would use the writing and communication skills that I learned from my English and my language arts teacher. Then I would go to the board and start doing problem-solving techniques by decomposing a problem that my engineering teacher taught me. You are here to learn how to learn, so you can get out of here and actually go apply it to learning things. Everything I did that was out of my major or my degree was because in school I learned how to learn, how to do research, how to work in teams. So when I got out there as a startup without any experience, I applied everything. I just want to share that with you guys. You are learning something very, very important here. You're learning the skills for doing it. Two more things, and then we'll stop. You can't do this alone. No matter how smart you think you are never as smart as you think you are. There is never a success story that one person said, no, it's a global company, and I run the whole thing myself with no employees. Okay? Never happened. Every success story in life was because of a team. So why did Kate ask you to do, why did you do networking in the beginning? Because it's one of the most important things you'll ever do. You should never come into any room like this or other words and not meet at least one or two people you did not know when you came in. Why? Because the power of your company, your future, will be defined by the power of your network. The person that you are sitting next to and failed to introduce yourself to might be your co-founder. They might be your investor. Right? There are community members in this room. If I was a young entrepreneur and I saw some of these community members and bank executives, etc., and failed to go introduce myself, what a wasted opportunity. The person next to you might be your partner, might be your employee, might be your co-founder, and might be your future spouse, which is actually more important than all those things. But you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. When you don't introduce yourself to people and talk, that's one more person that might have made a difference in your life, and you'll never know. Everywhere I go all the time, I am networking. And everywhere I go all the time, and I can't help this, everybody I meet, I wind up thinking to myself, could she be on our team? I'm always making a mental note, man, if I ever need a new accountant, I'm calling that girl. If I ever need another engineer, I'm calling that guy. The time to build your network is not at the last minute. When you say, I don't know how to do accounting and I don't know how to do marketing, and now you're off searching. You build your network every day of your life. Every company I launched, I already knew all the people I was going to call. We were up and running. When we started those kiosks, I was up and running by Friday because I had a network of people I called. Said, you, and you, who wants to be on the team? And they came. Your network is critically important. And you need to surround yourself with people smarter than you. By the way, I told you I got an engineering degree in our first company when we were building those boxes. I was writing code. And one day, my whole team staring at me. And I said, what? And they said, yeah, we're going to need you to back away from the keyboard. I said, guys, what's going on? They said, dude, you're the worst coder we've ever seen. I said, this is my degree. I got the same degree as you. And they said, nonetheless, you are literally the worst programmer we've ever seen. I said, I own the company. And they said, and still the worst programmer we've ever seen. I said, what do you guys want me to do? They said, anything but this. And I said, what? And they said, once we finish the product, someone has to sell it. Go study marketing. Right? And I wound up, I was never a good developer. I was a very good marketer. So surround yourself in everything. You are all good at only one thing. Don't kid yourself. Whatever your one thing is, find people smarter than you in every other area, and you will win. So I'm going to close with one last lesson about commitment and work ethic. And make sure it's still okay. And this is this. This is a friend of mine who's an athlete. He knows this in a sports story. His name's Evander Holyfield. If you guys don't know who he is, that's him knocking out Mike Tyson. But the more important story is the next fight, Mike Tyson bit his ear off. So people that don't even know boxing remember that Tyson bit my friend's ear off. So Evander was training for a fight. And I was just spotting for him before we went to Vegas for the fight. And he was doing this exercise that he does 300 times a day. It's insane. Normal human beings could not do this 3 times. You'd kill yourself. And he does it 300 times a day. Why? I don't know. It's just crazy. But he does it. So I'm spotting. And I'm counting. And Evander's finishing. And I said, 299-300. And Evander stopped after 300 reps with this giant weight behind his head and all those muscles rippling. He goes, Jeff, was that 299 or 300? I said, 300. And he goes, you sure? Was it 299 or 300? And he's still suspended in midair. And I said, it was 300. And he says, I think it was only 299. And he goes back down to the ground to do one more rep. And as he's coming up, this is the mistake I made. I rolled my eyes. Are you kidding me? You do this 300 times a day, and no one in the human race can do this twice, and you're stressed over whether it's 299 or 300. I rolled my eyes, and what Evander said next changed my life ever since then. It was an epiphany moment. He goes, Jeff, look at me. And I remember, told people this before, I remember thinking, well, that was a short life. This is not the guy exactly to be picking a fight with. But what he said next has nothing to do with sports and everything to do with the way you approach your life. He looked me in the eye, and he said, the difference between 299 and 300 is the difference between heavyweight champion of the world and every other boxer. And then he got up and walked away in dead silence. I didn't move for 10 minutes. I literally had goosebumps. And I stood there with my eyes closed because I wanted this to soak literally into my soul all the way through. And I'll tell you what happened. This was a young man from the hood with no hope for anything. And even though he would have chosen education if he had the choice over sports, he nonetheless came from the hood, never even slept in a bed in his entire life. They didn't even have a bed they were that poor. And wound up becoming the heavyweight champion of the world, seeing the world, and making, even though that wasn't his goal, making $300 million doing that. And I went home, and I wrote on my wall, 299 with a red circle and a slash through it. No 299s here. By the way, I love it when people write that where they live and send me a picture of it. I got somebody from Bulgaria sent me a picture of a no 299 on his wall the other day. And so I wrote that down, and I will close with this. I was at work one day, and I was writing a proposal. And I finished at midnight. Everyone had long gone home. And the proposal was good. This proposal will win this contract. Okay, it was good enough. It was $299. But what happens if $299 is good enough on Monday? On Tuesday, $298 is almost $299. That's pretty good. And if you're at $298, well, $297 on Wednesday, that's almost $290. That's almost $298. And you know what's happening? Someone, she's doing $300 right down the hall from you, and she's going to kick your butt. So I looked at that, and I said, this is good work. And I'm telling you this for every paper you write, every essay, every project you do in school, it's the attitude that winners have that everybody else doesn't. So I looked at that, and I said, this is a good proposal. It's good enough to win. But as I was walking out, I said, but is it 300? Is this literally, did I give this my best, or did I just do good enough? And I looked at it and said, it's 299. It's not 300. This isn't the best I can do. So I rolled my sleeves up, kicked my shoes off, poured some coffee, and stayed till 4:30 in the morning. When I left, I said, this is 300. This is the best I can do, and I left it all out there, okay? I sent the proposal off. 2 weeks later, the customer called. Said, first of all, we're stopping the proposal process. You win the business. Hands down, the best proposal we've ever seen. But a cool thing happened. She said, Jeff, I want to tell you something. We also did something we've never done in our company's history. And I said, what? She said, we were at a conference of our industry, where all our competitors there. And she said, at dinner that night, I told every other company at the table they shouldn't even submit a proposal. They should just buy your product, hands down the best. We closed 4 more contracts without writing one proposal. The difference between $299 and $300 for me was the difference between winning that business and getting 5 contracts that I never even bid on because our work was so excellent. So I want you guys to keep that in mind, that nothing worth having ever comes without giving $300. Without the effort. If you are not willing to work hard, you have to be willing to work as hard as your dreams are big. And if you are willing to do that, nothing can stop you. Whatever you dream of achieving, you can dream of. Thank you guys very much for having me. Where's the microphone? Right there. So if anybody has any questions, make a sound. Make a hurt animal sound. I don't know where you are from here. Anyone have a question?
Did you ever buy the car?
Okay, so the question was, did I ever buy the car? So I'll answer that. I don't usually, because I don't like to get into material stuff. But I did. Not bright red. It's all jet black on black leather with lipstick red trim on it. So I did buy the car, closed loop, and I got to just tell you one thing about it. The car is really loud. It's basically a racing Ferrari. And it's really, really loud. It's a race car. It's air inducted, actually, on the sides, like a jet engine, and it spins up. And one day somebody said, this just struck me, because my whole life I've been told, no, you're not good enough, you're such a dreamer. I'm sure somebody in this room has been told, you're such a dreamer, you need to be realistic. I've been told that my whole life, I just never bought it. My dreams were, I thought, should be my reality. So I've been told no my whole life. So when a friend of mine wanted to ride in the Ferrari, in the race car. And we get in the car and I started, and he said, geez, your car is so loud. And without a forethought at all, I said, yes, it is. It drowns out the sound of no. And I didn't realize until the moment I said that if I had listened to everybody in the world that said no, I would not be hearing this sound right now. So every time I start the car, I told you I'm not a car guy, but it reminds me that the only reason I'm hearing this sound is because I didn't accept everybody else's limits. Question in the back.
Hi, my name is Lady. I'm just Since you've had so many experiences with startups, my question is, how do you know when is it a good time to let a business go, and when is a good time to work through it?
Okay, so that's a really, really good question, thank you, and a really, really important one. Here's what happens. You get to the end of the year, and a lot of times I'm meeting with the investor and the entrepreneur. And I say, how did the year go? And simultaneously, the investor says horrible, and the entrepreneur says great. And I say, wait, you guys were in the same company in the same year. How could it be both horrible and great? And the investor says, I thought we'd get way more done. And the entrepreneur says, I can't believe how much we got done. So the question is, what exactly were you expecting? So here's the answer. I learned this the hard way. I didn't know this. The answer is, at the beginning of your startup, you gather your team at the beginning of every year. You gather your team and you take out two sheets of paper. You write down as definitively and quantifiably as you can, what does success look like? Then you take the other sheet and you write, what does failure look like? And you know what I do? I have all the team sign the failure one. And my employee said, what are we doing? I said, you're just pre-firing yourself. If the end of the year looks anything like this sheet, I should not have to walk anybody out of this building. Every one of us knows we failed and we'll go home. We're not going to wait until it's a big argument. So the answer is, define at the beginning of each year exactly what success looks like, define what failure looks like, and if it looks like the latter, move on. You have to be willing. The worst case, in fact, failing is not the worst thing. The worst thing is 5 years later saying we should have quit 4 years ago. I just wasted 4 years of my life and a bunch of money because we were pretty sure 4 years ago it wasn't really working. So that's the answer, is define it as objectively as you can, agree to it, and just say, guys, if we can't hit this, this business isn't working. Now, when you're missing it, you stop like a coach in a locker room at halftime. You say, is there any adjustments we can make? And if there are, adjust them and try a little more. But if the adjustments still don't make the numbers go up, if they still score three touchdowns and you score nothing the next quarter, it's over. That was your definition of failure. Move on. So you have to be able to let go. And by the way, the reason most entrepreneurs don't is not business, it's ego. You know what I call this now? I call it the Thanksgiving test. I was meeting two entrepreneurs the week before Thanksgiving. And the one guy was kind of in a bad mood. And I said, can I take a wild guess at something? And he said, what? And I said, you're not excited about Thanksgiving. And he's like, how would you know that? You don't know my family. And I said, you're in a bad mood and everyone's excited because next week they get to go home and visit their family for Thanksgiving. And he said, okay. And I said, here's my theory. I said, you borrowed money from all your friends and family, and you told them this was the greatest idea ever, and now you have to go home for Thanksgiving and tell everybody you failed. And he said, how did you know that? I said, just a lucky guess. Then I went to the girl who was in a great mood, and I said, can I ask you something? I said, you borrowed money from all your friends and family and told them you were going to be a success and the business is going great. She said, it is. I can't wait for Thanksgiving. Okay, it's ego. The one guy did not want to tell anybody he failed, so he just kept the company open. You have to be willing to be wrong, to take the laughter and abuse if that's what comes, and move on. But the only way you know that is if you know what success looks like way in advance and what failure looks like. Thank you for the good question. We have another one? Yeah.
Some say that the expression business ethics is an oxymoron. I don't believe that, but I would be interested in what your experience has been in dealing with ethical challenges. If you have examples of a business opportunity that you went ahead with, notwithstanding some qualms, and then come to regret it later, or another in which you confronted an ethical issue and decided whatever the profit, it simply is not worth going against my own personal values. Do you have examples like that for us?
You guys heard that too. It's not just the voices in my head, correct? That was a real guy. Sometimes I hear something. I have examples of only one of those, of the ones that, by the way, I 100% agree with you. You know what it was when I was growing up? Everybody would say that expression, nice guys finish last. And I'd say, what kind of stupid logic is that? And I would ask my parents or other people, what does that mean? And people say, well, you kind of have to be a little bit of a jerk to succeed in business. I said, no way did I ever believe that. So I have multiple deals when I was broke that people put money on the table and I left it to the ridicule of many people because it crossed my ethical boundaries and it didn't feel right. And you know, there are two true stories, and out of respect for them, I won't tell you who they are. Both of those gentlemen are in prison for fraud, and it turns out we recovered and did okay anyway. Always, always, always follow your values. I'm going to tell you one quick story about that. Early on, I had one of my software companies, I had Procter & Gamble as a customer. By the way, my single biggest customer. And we made a mistake. And it was our mistake. And it was a bad one we shouldn't have made. And I called the customer, and I know what my employees were thinking. They don't know. Just don't tell them, let's just fix it and go on. And I said, I can't go to sleep knowing that we screwed up and we just didn't tell them. It doesn't feel right. They're like, Jeff, we might lose. It's a contract violation. We'll lose our biggest customer. So I called Procter & Gamble, and I said, look, I know you don't know this, but we screwed up, and I need you to know what happened. And I told him, and he said, wow. He said, I can't believe you're confessing this. I said, why do you say that? And he said, because now we have to terminate you, because this is a contract violation. We didn't know about it. Now that we know, we're either going to lose this account. And he said, I'm pretty sure we're the single biggest customer you have. And I said, yes, this is going to be very, very painful for us to do. And he called me back about a week later. And he said, so I had the committee meeting. And I said, what happened? And he said, our lawyer read the contract and said, based on the agreement, we're terminated. We'll never do business with you again. And I said, sir, I'm so sorry. He said, except then we took a vote. And I said, what happened? And he said, our management team voted unanimously to not terminate the agreement because you guys represent the ethical standard we want to do business with. I would not have that agreement today if I didn't tell my employees we will always follow our ethics and our integrity and our values, no matter what the cost is. I have walked away from many deals and lots of money over the years that violated that. And that, by the way, should be the culture of your business, right? You create a culture, and our culture was always do the right thing. I used to tell people, you can't get fired for making a mistake at work, just screwing up in business, but you'll be fired instantly for violating our ethics or integrity. We ran all our businesses that way. We made mistakes, but we never made mistakes of integrity. So I thank you for that question. I think it's really, really important. And we always held the line. Do we have time for one more? One more question?
Jeff, can you talk?
Go ahead.
Can you talk a little bit about the power of self-development and spending time, you know, educating yourself outside of just formal education?
I thought we said no hard questions. So we're out of time. The question was about self-development. So tell me a little bit more of what you mean by that.
So outside of formal education, the importance of investing in yourself.
Okay, so the question was, outside of your formal education, you know, how do you invest in yourself and educating yourself? So there's a slide up here I didn't show, the one I skipped, that said info sponging. I spend time every single day doing research on what's going on in the rest of the world in industries I'm not even in. I think it's very important to invest in yourself, in your self-development, to use online tools very quickly, whether if it's a course they don't offer here that you could find on Coursera, or if it's a course you could go to the university and say, could you please start offering this, because I've talked to a lot of students and we need this. Helping yourself in educational online and offline offerings, watching TED Talks. I had a kid in Senegal email me because he watched my TED Talk and sent me a note. We connected that way. Looking at SlideShare, if you've ever done that, you want to know how to build an investor presentation, go to SlideShare. The best investor presentations in the world are on SlideShare. So use tools online and offline. Invest in your community, right? Like I said, there are people from Hills Bank sitting right here in this row. They could teach you a lot about finance and banking and managing money that you don't know you need to, but that isn't going to happen until you go to one of those people and say, can we have lunch one day? So I think you should invest in yourself and your education every place you can, every time you can, everywhere you can. And I spend a lot of time doing that. Kate, did we have one more or are we done? Where did Kate go? Okay, thank you.